And from the Triple Thrash treat to the Titans of Thrash, here's Tom and Carrie with a reminder of how to enter MTV's fantastic new competition called New Year's Aggression with Slayer.
This is Tom Ryan, Carrie King of Slayer, and Headbangers Ball is running a New Year's Aggression competition where you can start the new year off right in an angry way with Slayer in America.
Yep. You can be the lucky winner of an all-expenses-paid trip to America for a private gig with Slayer on New Year's Eve. All you have to do is answer this very simple question. Who produced our live record? And for more information, here's Vanessa for further details.
Slayer dudes!
Know that before becoming involved with music, Tom worked in a hospital as a respiratory therapist.
And another interesting thing, Kerry's hobbies include breeding snakes and show dogs. More Slayer facts next week, but right now Headbangers Ball is very proud to present a Slayer documentary in which Tom, Kerry and Dave trace the history of the band from its formation in LA in 81 right through their decade of aggression to the present day. Take a look at this.
In the early days, what inspired me and the band, you know, as far as musically, was the punk movement that was going on. It wasn't at its peak, but it was more or less, you know, little dying as it is, you know. So we would like listen to a lot of punk at that time, and then I would like get excited when I would listen to punk music, you know, and the music would like make me like play a little faster, and then sometimes they would come up with a riff that would be at a certain speed. I would double that riff and make it more of a faster, you know, type song, you know. So the music that I was listening to at the time inspired Slayer a lot.
I guess what inspired me most about writing this kind of music was the people that inspired me the least, like the Poisons from Southern California, the other kind of bands were popping out around then. All the glam thing was huge, and I wanted to be as far away from that as possible. You know, I thought if those guys were selling records being women, we should be able to do something good being men.
A band coming out of LA, or a band coming out of that, at that time when glam was such a big thing, it was the only thing we knew. You know, bands in Hollywood were all doing that kind of shit, so we figured, hell, you know, let's try something like that. So, and that's where the idea of the spikes and stuff came out. But I mean, it took one weekend in San Francisco to sort of just throw all that out the window, because you know, from what we were told that it wasn't necessary. And, you know, but I mean, you know, you're coming out of an area where that's like the thing, you know, theatrics, trying to look evil. And, you know, we figured that, hell, we can just look evil the way we are, you know, it's like, it's no big deal.
What's your favourite Slayer album?
Rain in Blood, definitely. Rain in Blood.
Rain in Blood.
Rain in Blood, Scott Bay.
Well, Rain in Blood was like the epitome of thrash to us at the time, and apparently to most everyone else since then, because you see it in every reader's poll as the top thrash record of all time, so I guess we did something right with that one. You know, we were very into fast riffs then, obviously, because every song was based on a fast riff. And had no idea it was going to be 30 minutes long. We just made up 10 songs and it was over, you know, done recording, and says, well, there's 28 minutes. You got any more songs? We said, nope. It's 10 songs, you know. It's complete. It doesn't need any more for what it was. And lyrically, it was all me and Jeff on Rain and Blood. And mine were the horror fantasy type things. I think that was like the beginning of Jeff getting seriously into war songs like Angel of Death, even though we'd done Chemical Warfare much earlier. Right after we did Rain and Blood, after we toured for a while, we said, man, the next record, we gotta do something way slower, because fast was getting old for us. And I didn't want to, Jeff or me, neither one wanted to get to the point where we never wanted to play fast again. So I said, well, let's take a turn and make up the slower, heavier album. And that's how the majority of that record came into be. Seems to me the only one that even resembles Rain and Blood is Ghosts of War. But everything else was like a new thing, obviously, especially Spill the Blood, you know, with a, it's not an acoustic sound, but it's a clean guitar chord medley thing, which we'd never done before. So that was kind of our breaking ground for that record, aside from a complete different vocal approach.
Yeah, that was something that I had a lot to do with. That was, aside from the fact that they didn't have a lot of songs written lyrically, so I took the opportunity to start pinning stuff down and wrote South of Heaven. I helped finish, we co-wrote Read Between the Lies, Cleanse the Soul I wrote, Mandatory, what? Screaming?
Silent Scream.
Silent Scream. I'm almost forgetting my shit. No, and I took the opportunity to, you know, to take a pin. I had been writing some stuff. I had, you know, a notebook full of little ideas and stuff that I'd written and just things that I'd worked with, and decided to do it. And said, what do you guys think? Like, cool. So we went into the studio, and at the time when we were in the studio at the time, Carrie was going through a certain point in his life where it drew him away from the studio. So it gave me and Jeff an opportunity to make all the decisions. And that's, you know, that's basically what's something that me and Jeff had worked out. And, you know, I kind of liked working at the idea of like singing certain songs, even though it didn't sound like I was singing. But I thought it was pretty good, you know. But, you know, to me, it's a good album. I think it was like a sidestep, and it kind of freaked everybody out, you know. But, hey, that's the whole idea of being creative, is to, like, the next time you sort of, like, surprise everybody. Raise and out life is dead, decisions in my head. Anticipation, the stimulation, to kill the exhilaration. Close your eyes, look deep in your soul, step outside yourself and let your mind go. Frozen eyes, step deep in your mind as you die. Step outside yourself and let your thoughts stray as you go insane.
After we did South of Heaven, I knew right after that I wanted the next record to be between Rain in Blood and South of Heaven, because to me, South of Heaven, it's a great record, but we left things behind we shouldn't have left behind. We left behind some speed, we left behind some aggression, and we left behind a vocal style that wasn't really present on South of Heaven. So my writing state of mind, I said, we gotta go back and get this stuff, because I don't want to be the type of band that just makes a left turn leaving stuff behind. I want to make left turns and carry everything with me. The writing style is pretty similar. I mean, it's right in between. I mean, the songs are right in between South of Heaven, Rain and Blood. You've got your Rain and Blood style, you've got your South of Heaven style, and maybe with a song like Temptation, you have a style more like the Hell Awaits era of writing, you know, lots of riffs working in the same song. Lyrically, it's similar to everything we've done, just different points of view, different aspects. We went back and picked up the aggressive vocal style, which was the icing, you know, just made it work. I think Seasons in the Abyss is the most complete record we've ever done. You've got your violence, you've got your bloodshed, you've got your rape, your court cases, your murder. That's on public television now, and it never was when I was growing up. So obviously, society is escalating in a violent manner. And I think Tom takes that aspect in his writing, and I just go on to the horror fantasy stuff because that's what I've always been into.
Yeah, I'm more the one that sort of kind of put the two and two together. You know, because the imagery that they had with Shown of Mercy when they first wrote Shown of Mercy, I was like, I thought it was cool. You know, I was like, wow, these are great songs. I was like, yeah. You know, Hell Awaits was just as good, you know, and Chemical Warfare. And I was like, oh my God, it just got better and better, you know. And then, you know, and at that time, that's when I started writing. I figured, well, shit, I'm going to try it, you know. So I just started like jotting little notes and stuff, and then started writing things on my own and things that I thought were really neat. And then when the opportunity came, I just sort of, and it went, you know, it goes well with the band because of what we represent. To me, I think there's a lot more, you know, to music. And even though I say things in a very, like, very ugly and negative way, I'm hoping to reverse it and to bring up, to like try to like show that there's a little flickering candle way at the end of the tunnel, you know, and hopefully somebody else will see that. And the idea is to get to that fucking light, get to the candle. You know, I'm just telling you, you know, my views and what I see. You know, and if you want to reach for that light, dude, more power to you. Do it, because that's the only way to, you know, the only way to go. I think it was during South of Heaven. Someone had mentioned something about a live album, and we thought, nah, let's not do a live album. Let's just, you know, it's just old stuff and this and this and that. And so we figured, nah. And then it got brought up again when we were working with Seasons, when we first started like rehearsing for Seasons. And we were sitting there, and it dawned on us that we had been together for 10 years. And, you know, and we thought, God, you know, that's a good idea for a live album. And that's when it was brought up. And I think that's what the discussion was, you know. And then we sat there and thought about, well, what would we call it, you know. And then the name Decadent Aggression was, but I don't know who brought that up. But that
name came up like in recording, okay, like year or so ago. So we didn't copy Motley Crue.
No. It came up, you know, and we thought the name was cool, and we thought, God, that'd be a neat way. We sat there and said, well, can we make it like a special package? Can we do this? Can we do that? We need to, like, and our manager was like, yeah, this would be great. This would be great. You know, and it's like, well, is this like no, this is not a filler. This is just something, 10 years. Just put it out for the kids. Give it to them. Live, straight, no overdubs. Are you sure you know? Yeah, no overdubs. So we listened to the Wembley, Wembley audio. And we decided that it'd be a good idea if we recorded another show. And we recorded the show in Lakeland. And then we also took Wembley and also San Bernardino, which was recorded earlier. And we just sort of picked out the songs that, you know, we kept one entire set. And we picked out the songs, the other two sets. And the album was put together just for that, just like, this is 10 years, thanks. You know, we put like a little picture booklet and stuff. And just something like this. Just something for the kids, and we tried to keep it as you know, as cheap as possible. You know, kind of like, hey, happy birthday, guys! Thanks. Yeah.
I got a little different aspect of that live thing. Like when I was growing up, listening to rock, metal, or whatever, all the bands I liked put out live albums, so I was used to that cycling, so to speak. I mean, UFO, Strangers in the Night. You know, every band I like had live albums, so that's what I was used to. And that, you know, it's just another aspect, you know. I was just used to a cycling of a live record. If we waited any longer for this, there'd be a lot of songs that wouldn't be on this record that are now. I think now's a good time. We've got songs from every record on it, which I think is real important. You cover the complete span of everything you recorded, and I think the kids are going to dig it. Watch it unfold. I am the Antichrist. This would have meant to be. You got left me behind. It's in my soul to be free. I look, you're looking at me now, you know, and I'm talking. But when you see me or you see us on stage, it's a different situation. And I think it's the same way with the kids. Kids do the same thing. They go for one night, they go, and then they're like spaz out, you know, and then they're all better, you know. They go home, and because it's the same with me, it's like a release, because I, you know, it's like I'll be like this all day long. I'm not go up there and I spaz out like crazy, and after I'm done, I'm like, it's like, oh my God, you know, it's like you just want to just like be left alone and just have silence. And it's the same with them. They go walking out, they walk out like, you know, it's like it's like if you're almost floating, because you're like almost stupefied, you know, just the intensity and like the rage that you had inside you, and you walk away all like you know, like feathers, you know, like you're walking on feathers, because it's just, I think it's the same kind of release. I think the kids get the same thing that I get, and that's just total, like, just, I don't know, it's just kind of like a, it's like
It's hard to explain, man.
I mean, I see like this electric field between the fans. I know since I'm up on the drum riser, I see like this energy, you know, between us and them, that it's like, it's incredible. I think it's just like a form of a release and a form of, you know, just a mutual energy type thing that the kids get off on the same as we do.
Slayer, they know what we want.
I think the secret of success for Slayer is no compromise. We don't compromise to the record company. We don't compromise to our merchandising company. We don't compromise to, you know, anything for anybody. It's, you know, if we don't like to do something or if we don't want to do something, we won't do it.
Persistence.
Lack of compromise.
Yeah, we've sort of, you know, it's like 10 years of running into fucking brick walls, and we just sort of kept bulldozing our way through, not giving a fuck about anything. And, you know, just doing it. Doing it and not really listening to anybody but ourselves. You know? And coming across people that are doing a lot for us now, who haven't turned their backs on us. So I think a lot of it has to do with the people that we've managed to, managed to sort of join our family, I guess. And without them, shit, we wouldn't be here. So a lot of it has to do with honest people, I guess.
Slayer.
I've been a fan of Slayer for a long time now. I think they've actually done a lot for this sort of music, and I really salute their efforts in really bringing it from, kind of a nominal area to as big as it is today.
Mm-hmm. And they're celebrating 10 years together with their double live album.
The new live album.
Which leads me to wonder, might Morbid Angel ever release a live album?
Well, that's a good question. Certainly we've thought a lot about it. We don't have any concrete plans at the moment, but we'll see.
And if they...